This chapter on nucleic acids is one of the most important for biochemistry. In this chapter, we talk about DNA, which contains information for all the living organisms, and plus it provides a mechanism for passing those characteristics to offspring. We could envision DNA as containing the language of life. Let's look at the structure of DNA. It's a polymer. Proteins are polymers. Some carbohydrates are polymers. The repeating units in DNA are called nucleotides, and there are three components, a sugar, a phosphate, and a base in each nucleotide. Let's look at the structure of DNA in a little more detail. Here I've got a segment of DNA that's three nucleotides long. Up here's the phosphate group. Phosphorus is surrounded by four oxygens. One of those is to a double bond between the oxygen and phosphorus, two negative charges. And these negative charges might be associated with magnesium, say, a magnesium 2+. Here's the sugar part of the molecule. This is similar to ribose, except there's no oxygen at this position. And so it's called deoxyribose. Deoxy means without an oxygen at that position. The base is attached here at the ring at position 1. And I haven't drawn out the structure of the base, but it too would have a numbering system around the ring. And because of that, we give these numbers in the ribose or deoxyribose ring the prime notation. So this would be the 1', 2'. Here at 3', we have a phosphate group linking to the next nucleotide. Up here would be the 5' position, and I've shown it sort of as an elbow kind of arrangement. The intersection of those two lines, though, is a carbon atom. Here's a phosphate linking these two nucleotides together between the 3' and the 5' position. Phosphate has these ester linkages that are linking the two sugars together, and so we call those phosphodiester bonds or linkages. The bases, just arbitrarily, I've put them in as A, T, and G. The other base that occurs commonly in DNA is C. Down here at the end of the molecule is the 3' position, and we could put a phosphate down there. I just left it as the OH. The important thing to note is that these two ends are different. This is the 5' end, this is the 3' end. So DNA is a directional molecule. Let's look at another abbreviation of the structure. Here I've abbreviated the structure of a DNA segment. It's really just phosphate linked to a sugar, phosphate linked to a sugar, phosphate linked to a sugar. That repeats over and over again. And two DNA molecules would differ from each other only in the length of the strand and the sequence of bases that are attached. Up here, I've written it in a horizontal fashion. And because DNA is a directional molecule, that is to say, the two ends are different, by convention, the one on the left is the 5', the one on the end on the right is the 3' end of the molecule. And this PS, etc., is called the backbone of the DNA molecule. And the nucleotide structure that we drew just a few moments ago that contained three nucleotides, we could really abbreviate the structure since all nucleic acids are alike in the phosphorus, sugar, just to indicate the three bases, the sequence A, T, and G. And again, by convention, this is the 5' end of the molecule, this is the 3'. In a way, comparing nucleic acid structure to protein structure, where in proteins we had primary, secondary, and tertiary structure, and quaternary, we might call this the primary structure of a nucleic acid. Let's look at the secondary. The secondary structure of nucleic acids, or DNA, was proposed in 1953 by Watson and Crick. They received the Nobel Prize for their work. They came up with the double helix for DNA. And I wanted to mention, too, that Linus Pauling was not far behind. Linus Pauling, you recall, had proposed the helical structure for proteins, and he was proposing a helical structure for nucleic acids as well. And to complicate things a little more, Linus Pauling's son was rooming, I've forgotten, with Watson or Crick in England at the time. So it was sort of a controversial thing. And controversial in another way, too, because Watson and Crick used data of a couple other scientists with their permission, but when they were awarded the Nobel Prize, Rosalind Franklin's name was omitted. And that was corrected in years later when she, too, received the Nobel Prize. One of the pieces of chemical information that Watson and Crick had at that time was that the ratio of A and T in a DNA molecule is 1:1. That is to say, the amount of A equals the amount of T, and the amount of G equals the amount of C. And the secret to coming up with the structure of DNA was to solve this riddle right here. And what they proposed was that DNA is double-stranded. And wherever you encounter an A in one strand, opposite it in the other strand is a T. Opposite every G is a C, and so forth. And this then would give a DNA molecule in which A equals T and G equals C. And we know now that these two bases are held together by two hydrogen bonds. When G and C occur in opposite strands, they're held together by three hydrogen bonds. Let's look at these two strands again here on the board to the left. I've repeated the two strands up here and shown one of the strands in blue. These two strands are said to be complementary, or the sequences are complementary. Furthermore, they're anti-parallel. That is to say, the direction on one strand is opposite to the direction on the other strand. 5' to 3' on this side, and just the opposite in the other strand. The final piece of the puzzle was for Watson and Crick to propose the double helix. And this, the two helical strands are held together by hydrogen bonding then between the base pairs. One of the skills that we'd like you to have, well, we'd like you to have a basic understanding of DNA structure and some of the things that we've gone over here, but we'd also like you to be able to come up with complementary sequences. If we gave you a sequence in one strand, what's the sequence in the other strand? Let's practice once with that. If you were asked to write the complementary sequence to a DNA segment, it's a little bit tricky. You have to keep in mind that perhaps you'll be asked to write the sequence in the 5' to 3' direction. We know that opposite every G is a C, and so this top one over here, it's the complementary sequence, isn't it, to this? CCTAA would be the complementary sequence. But because these two strands are anti-parallel, this response is really in the 3' to 5' direction. And if you were asked in the question to simply write the complementary sequence without specifying 3' and 5', then by convention, you're going to be writing it in the 5' to 3' direction. So you'd want to turn this sequence around. This then would be the correct response, because this is written in the 5' to 3' direction. We've turned this one around. So be careful as you're doing that. Make sure that you write your response in the 5' to 3' direction.